business software development. Computer applications were highly specialized. You remember I mentioned in the beginning that when the first mainframe computers appeared, they were so expensive that you really needed some highly specialized high-volume processing tasks. And even at that time, those mainframes were often leased, not bought, because they were so expensive. So Payroll was developed, general ledger systems were developed, and some early inventory management systems were developed. They were developed separately. When each application was developed, it had to work with data. So it had to create a format for the data that it worked with, then store the data, and then retrieve and process the data. So every programmer, who at that time most likely used the core model, which we don't have now, this, I used to talk about chapter 4 that we don't cover, actually discusses different types of software, and talks about different generations of programming languages. It's something we know that one of the earliest generic languages was COBOL, and it was really designed mostly for business processing. What is interesting, you know, I mentioned to you that one of the earliest programmers were actually women. So the inventor of COBOL was a woman called Grace Hopper, who actually ended her career as a rear admiral in the US Navy. So she worked for the government, but the programming language that she invented turned out to be the main business programming language. And even today, when, look, it's been more than 50 years, close to 60, since the development of COBOL, you can still find COBOL programmers. As a matter of fact, since for the younger generation of programmers, this is not a particularly exciting language, so the young guys are not really looking forward to programming COBOL. Surprisingly, even today in some places there are COBOL programmer shortages because, you know, people age and retire. And if the new generation doesn't pick it up, then, say, banks and insurance companies may be facing some issues because they still have a lot of COBOL software and not that many people who can work with it. So all those early business programs were pretty much written in COBOL, where you had this extensive data section where you had to define the structure of your data, what the fields are, what the format of the fields is, and then write the code that worked with that data. So every application defined its own format and used its own files. So this is what you see depicted on this slide. So you have one application that deals with sales, it will have its own set of files, right? You have another application that maybe deals with accounts payable, which was very common. These days, we consider it part of the order-to-cash cycle. Now there is this expression of the order-to-cash that encompasses both sales and payables, collections. Now, in those days, in the 60s and the 70s, the sales cycle is a separate cycle, and the accounts receivable cycle is a separate cycle. So when you collect an accounts receivable, that's a separate cycle. Even though, obviously, you are collecting on the receivables generated by your sales, right? So imagine that this application too is this accounts receivable application. And let's say application 3 is let's say your inventory application, okay? So, if you just look at this, you may not realize that there is a big problem. Why is the big problem with this? Well, let's discuss what those files are, so for this problem. So what kind of files would such applications need? Let's start with sales. And let's imagine that for a second that we are dealing, say, with a merchandising business. So this is a company which basically sells inventory of their goods, right? Application one is a sales program. So what would be file A? What is the primary key? Well, it shouldn't come to you as no surprise that most likely say file A, let's say in this case, would be your sales transaction file. Okay? So this is the file where you record your sales transactions. Reasonable, right? So you need a file to record your sales transactions. Remember we talked in the previous chapter, we talked about transaction files, master files, you know, reference files, history files. So file A is your sales file, sales transaction file. So then what about file B? Again, we're dealing with credit sales, right? So obviously, you need to keep records of your customers, your selling, right? Reasonable. Okay. So let's say file B is your customer's master file. Okay. So what about file C? So this is a merchandising business. No. Address, this is a part of the customers, right? You remember we talked about it. Do you remember the data hierarchy? Bit, byte, field, record, file. So file C then probably is your inventory file. So this is the record of the items that you are selling to your customers. Right? Okay, so far so good. Okay, so let's look at application two. So this is your accounts receivable, right? So you are collecting on your sales. So if this is your accounts receivable application, right? So one of very important things for you would be to know what the customers owe you, right? So it should come as no surprise that you also have to have a customer's file that your accounts receivable application works with. Right? So let's imagine that file B is your customer's file. So I intentionally told you that file B was the customer's file for application one. Now, file B is also a customer's file for application two. The problem is that those two are different files. So file B that application one uses is a different file from file B that application two uses. And why is that? Well, in many cases it is absolutely inevitable for a very simple reason that at that time, with very high likelihood, those applications could run on different computers. So if you have programs running on different computers, there was no widespread use of networking at that time. So every computer would use files of their local storage. So it cannot be any other way. There are other reasons. Even if you run these programs on the same computer, if those are two completely separate programs, and they keep changing files, you cannot really run two programs at the same time that attempt to change the same file at the same time, simply because they will be in conflict. Okay? And the operating system is not particularly good at, they will lock the file while one program is using it so that the other cannot use it, but it becomes a really awkward. So even if they were running on the same computer, it would not be easy to make two different programs use the same customer master file. So in all those cases, inevitably, application one and application two would utilize their own separate copies of the customer master file. Is that clear? Because this is a very important point. So this is what I'm trying to explain. So when we hit, yes.
Different in what way? Different in what way?
Like just completely separate files. Just imagine that you are writing your term paper.
But are they the same customers?
Yes. That's exactly the point. Yes, they are exactly the same customers.
It's still different.
But the files themselves, like the files in your computer.
On it.
Very good. You are going in the very, in the, exactly the direction where I want to go. So the question is, okay, so they are the same customers, right? And the information, therefore, in both files has to be exactly the same. Excellent. And how can we guarantee that? Okay. Imagine that, let's say you create a new customer. And we'll talk later about this. So when you're selling credit, there has to be a certain process that controls the creation of a new credit customer. But let's say a new credit customer is created. So the sales program enters that customer in their sales file. And the accounts receivable program, the people who run it, they enter that exactly same information on their version of the customer. Well, everybody has to enter. Yes, they have to enter it separately. It's a separate file. And very likely, maybe even different people are running them. And let's say they do it. So again, you can see that there may be a problem already at that step, right? But let's say they do. For the sake of an argument, let's say, okay. So they follow the rules, they do. Now imagine, so this is an ongoing business, right? So imagine that one of the customers, so they have these active business ties, and they move, right? Those people, they don't stay put all the time. They can move, right? They can move to a different location. They can change their phone number. Happens, right? So what do they do? So the customer probably keeps in touch with their salespeople, right? This is how it works. So when customers buy something, so those people who they keep in touch with are usually salespeople who actually will accept their orders. So they're good customers, they get in touch with those salespeople and tell them, listen, we moved. This is our new address and this is our new phone number. Okay? And those salespeople are good, responsible employees. So they make sure that the information is updated. When? Well, you see that because of the, in a large organization, okay, yes, they will update it in the version of the customer master file that the sales program uses. What about accounts receivable? Accounts receivable is a separate department. Those are really accountants, right? Paper pushers. They are not salespeople, right? They are not going out in the field. They are not keeping in touch with the customers, right? So, is there a process that makes sure that whenever this happens, it gets propagated everywhere? Well, I mean, you would hope, right? But but you realize that this is not how things usually work in practice. So the end result of this story was that when people started using this, so over the years, those things kept accumulating. By the way, you do realize that this is a problem. So because they sold the goods, they shipped the goods. Now the accounts receivable people are trying to contact that customer, but they don't have the current address or phone number. So that sounds like a problem, right? So how do you deal with it? Well, in a way, it was structurally inevitable, simply because of how it was organized. And early on, that was the way we developed software. So it's not a recent revelation. So people started encountering those issues pretty early on. And people started talking about this problem fairly early on. Okay, so that there is an issue with the file-based systems when they are deployed in a large enterprise. That this is not a particularly good model. certificate. So, just to summarize, so the problem stems from this basic issue, that we have this data redundancy, and we'll talk about that over and over again. So, if the same piece of information is stored more than once, then there is always some likelihood that there will be problems with the information integrity. That there will be some versions which will not be up to date. Okay? And so the information will be out of sync. As people used to say at that time, that there was no single version of truth. So you look at different parts of your system and they tell you a different story. So additionally, so there was this technical issue, you know, that I showed you a very, very simplified schematics with three files per application. In reality, those applications used hundreds, in many cases, thousands of files. So when we talk in chapter 7 about system development lifecycle, that you will see that people use a terminology of file library, okay? Because they dealt with so many different files. So it's a royal pain to maintain those files. Another thing is, even though, say you, let's say you have already developed a program for sales, so you already thought about this issue, you have to work with the customer's records, right? And define the structure of the customer's record. So where was it described? The structure of the data you were working with. It was described in the code of that program for processing sales. Now, if you start writing another program for processing, say, accounts receivable, and you again face the same issue that, okay, you have to work with customers' records. So you have to actually keep doing the same thing, creating the data structures for representing your customers. And you have already solved this problem. I mean, from the enterprise point of view. So you keep, and by the way, not only it's not free, you keep paying those programmers for something that has already been done. Also, it takes much longer, okay? Unnecessarily long. So it's also bad, I mean, this lengthy. And this is due to the fact that our data is not independent, quote-unquote, from the processing subroutines. So the same COBOL program that defines the calculations that we have to do, say, when we record sales, also defines the format of the customer's data. So they are not independent. So to make it possible to keep reusing something we have already done, we have to separate this issue, the issue of defining what our data is. So if it is a customer, so what is the issue? The issue is, so we need to work with the customers. What is a customer? And a customer is a record consisting of, most likely, customer ID, right? Customer address, customer phone number, the name of the customer representative, right? Customer's credit limit, very important. The current balance on the customer's account. Is there anything important I have forgotten? Well, probably yes. There will be some additional things, for example, most likely there will be some critical dates. There will be a date when the customer was authorized. There may be the identity of the authorizer, so there can be some fields to represent your control procedures. So there will be other things, but anyway, so there is this generic problem that I have to solve. How I represent the customer? And it's absolutely necessary, it has to be solved, but I only want to solve it once. And after I have solved it, I want to make this solution available to whatever potential programs we may need to get to work with the customers. Okay? Whether it is our sales program, whether it is our accounts receivable program, whether later on we start developing, as they now call, customer relationship management applications, where we're keeping in touch with the customers, asking them about their experience with our products, keeping track of all that. So there may be other things that we may want to do with the customers. I will still need this description of a customer. I want to solve it once and forever. Okay? So how do I do so? Do you understand what I'm going on? Okay, so I don't want to keep doing it in every application program I may have to write. Okay? This is exactly what databases were created. Okay? To separate the problem of data definitions and data storage from the problem of data processing. So different application programs will process data differently depending on what those programs are supposed to do, whether they process sales, receivables, inventory, whatever. But we want to have a separate way to define our data and store our data and make it available, hopefully at the same time, to all those different applications. This is what is known as concurrent access. So we'll talk about concurrency. It's actually an issue. Now, if we design a database program for that, it will solve the issues that we're having, because it will eliminate the root cause of our problems, okay? Which was data redundancy. So the root cause of our problems was data redundancy. So we want to eliminate data redundancy. And this is what we designed database programs for. In a database, we want every element of data to be stored once and available everywhere. Questions? Okay, so what is a database management system? Well, it is a program. It is a program, and as any program, yes, it also works with files on the hard drives. But all that is hidden from the application programs. So the mechanics of what a database management system does is completely hidden. It is not exposed. What is exposed to the application programs is the structure of the data. So you can find in the database what the structure of the data is, what the data elements are, what their format is, and some other more sophisticated features that we'll discuss later. And this is what the programs use. So basically, these programs can be kept completely agnostic about how that data is actually stored on the hard drives and retrieved from the hard drives. That's not their job. They know that the database program will do it for them. And good to know, if we don't have to worry about this, this will only make our program simple, which we want. Okay? And yes, it works on top of an operating system. Again, we don't have these chapters 3 and 4, but you know that computers have operating systems. You know that you run Microsoft Windows, right? And if you use a smartphone, you use a different operating system, right? It may be iOS in case of Apple, right? Or most likely, if you don't use an Apple iPhone, that you probably have an Android. Right? So those are other types of operating systems. So those operating systems are programs that take care of all this nitty-gritty thing that the computer does, right? So everything works through operating systems, including the database system. But the database system takes this to a different level of abstraction. Regular programs have to worry about files. You work with a document in Microsoft Word, you have to click save, right? to make sure that that file is saved, updated on the hard drive. Right? So basically, you have to give an explicit instruction to save your data on the hard drive. Now, with the application programs, you don't want to worry about anything like that. You're just sending it to the database management system, say, update the cell. Now, how that database program does it, how it actually changes the information on the hard drive, it's its own issue. And this is actually really, really, really important development. It liberated application development from this very significant work. Okay, so what is a database? Several points here. So first of all, it's an integrated repository. In a way, it's our ambition. So what does it mean that it is an integrated repository? It means that it contains absolutely all types of data that an organization has to work with. So the ambition of database management systems is that in every organization, you have just one database. And by the way, this is still an ideal, because when you start working for large organizations, that you will realize that they still use a lot of different databases, unfortunately. But the ideal is that, okay, let us have a single database, which is this global repository for our organization that contains absolutely everything. Okay? All the data sets that we can potentially need. So whatever they are, customers, employees, vendors, yes. Microsoft Office is the so-called application suite. There is a database management program which is sold as a part of the professional version of Microsoft Office, which is called Microsoft Access. Okay, which is, as I mentioned earlier, is actually a so-called personal database, because it is not designed to support a large number of simultaneous users. But it looks and feels and behaves in other respects as a real database. So we'll use Microsoft Access because it's a convenient tool for us. It is also convenient for small tasks. Think about it like an example of an amateur tool which is sold for those, you know, weekend do-it-yourself people, right? And of course, if I do something once a year, it's perfectly fine for me, right? I want to buy a chainsaw that I use, I don't know, a couple of times a year. It's going to be different than if I had to use chainsaw 8 hours a day, every day, right? So that's the difference with Microsoft Access, let's say Microsoft SQL Server, which is an enterprise class database that Microsoft sells. And of course, it's not a part of any application suite, it's just a relational database. So Microsoft has an enterprise level database. We're not going to use it because it will just unnecessarily complicate our lives. So we're going to use Microsoft Access, which to you will look and feel exactly the same. Okay? Now. Yes. Yeah, we're aspiring. It's not, okay, so the question is, why is it still an ideal? There are a number of reasons. There are technical reasons, and there are organizational reasons, okay? So the technical reason is that depending on what you are doing with your data, there may be very strict performance requirements. So for example, when you are recording, if you are talking about a very large enterprise, and you are, say, recording different types of transactions, for example, sales, cash receipts. In a large enterprise, you're going to have those transactions happening all the time. And when people record transactions, they want their system to be responsive. So So when you're dealing with online systems, I can tell you that a human responds to it to a delay of even a few seconds. So if you click a button and it takes a few seconds for the system to respond, you feel it as a lag. People will use the expression that the system kind of sluggish. So if that delay goes to something like 20 or 30 seconds, people find it unbearable. Okay? So we're talking about the response times, which preferably should be under a second. Okay? And so you have to design databases in a special way to guarantee that. So we're going to talk about this. We'll have a separate chapter where we'll discuss something called database normalization. And one of the objectives of that would be exactly to make this happen, so that those databases really behave like that. But you also want to use that data for many other things in the enterprise. For example, you want to run your models and calculate your sales forecasts. Okay? And that thing may require much more intensive number crunching. So if you attempt to do it on the same database that supports your routine transaction processing, theoretically, you can do that. The end result will be that if you are using some, there are some very computationally intensive models that you can estimate. So if you try to do that, it will impose severe computational penalties. It's like your computer starts crunching a lot of numbers. It is even very powerful computers will be very busy with that. And what will happen, the response time for routine transactions will start increasing. So there are technical reasons not to do it. There are organizational reasons because of how the enterprise is structured and the issues associated with the maintenance and governance of those databases. So there are still, we, by the way, it's not as fragmented as it used to be. When I talk in chapter 14 about ERP systems, I will tell you that even, well, okay, I've been around now. Well, I can tell you that I have seen with my own eyes this process of reducing the number of different databases in very large companies. You see, I've seen this happen with companies like Johnson & Johnson. I've seen it happen with companies like Siemens, where, you know, those are global companies, huge companies with dozens, in many cases hundreds of thousands of employees, and how they diligently try to reduce the number of different databases, consolidate things, right? Make bigger chunks. And they've been doing this, but it takes time. Will we ever get to a state where that you truly have just a single database in an enterprise for absolutely everything? I don't know. It's difficult. So this is what we aspire to. So this is our ideal. So we want this completely integrated single repository with a single version. But you know, I can tell you that the companies are getting pretty good at really eliminating redundancy. So there may be different databases still, but they are usually such that they store separate things. So this, you know, war against data redundancy has been mostly successful. So, and that's very important. So this is, as you know, our bread and butter is transaction processing. So we're an accounting systems class. So what matters to us most at this stage is transaction processing. So if I were teaching a strategic management class in an MBA program, I would have it somewhat different. But for this class, my concern is transaction processing. So if we manage to eliminate data redundancy, it greatly facilitates this part. Okay, so what else? Well, there is an interesting remark here, which I want actually to take an issue. Now, database development started in the mid-1960s. So believe it or not, so already in the mid-1960s, so very early on, people, in particular IBM, realized that it was very important to develop databases for business applications. So very, very few years. You know, you have experience, well, maybe 5-6 years developing business applications, you already understand this, you know. People are smart creatures. They understand what kind of problems they face pretty good and start working. Now, at that time, computers were very limited. So they had very limited processing capacity, the storage was very limited. It imposed severe restrictions on how those databases were developed. So the earliest databases that were developed from the late 1960s through 1970s and 1980s were quite different from the databases that we use today. Even though the main one which appeared at the time, you can still find it. So IBM at that time started developing what they called Information Management System, IMS. Okay. And this was an example of the so-called hierarchical database. I don't have any time to talk and go into any details. The only thing I want you to know is just to tell you that those early hierarchical databases were much closer, their design was much closer to the way how actual physical storage happened. So they were much closer to the way that those computers worked physically. And therefore, they were much more constrained in what they did. You could make them very fast to answer certain types of questions, certain types of queries. But then, if you want to do something else, it may be a real problem. But they improved very drastically. So I can tell you that maybe even 15 or 20 years ago, the largest databases in this country were probably still IMS databases. I always, you know, and that was the type of ERP which uses different databases. IMS is a really powerful program. It still exists. There are newer versions of IMS. It's still out there. And until, I think, fairly recently, maybe 15, maybe 20 years ago, that contained the largest data sets available. That was before what we called today the age of big data. So if I ask you, you know, 25 years ago, what is the largest database that any commercial enterprise uses in the United States? By the way, I have no clue about government applications. So obviously, there is intense interest by the government and whatever national security agency uses. I have absolutely no clue. But I can tell you, as far as the commercial entities are concerned, so in the early 1990s, probably the largest commercial database was an IMS database that kept call record details. Because, you know, well, these days you're not dealing with this, but at that time, you know, that phones were still expensive. So it was the time when you really had to pay a lot of money for the so-called long distance calls. Have you even heard this expression, long distance? Because it lost its meaning now. There is no meaning, I mean, it doesn't... you had to sign up for different plans that would give you different rates for long distance. And basically, phone companies, local Baby Bells and AT&T, they maintained extensive databases of customer records and call record details. And those were in IMS. Now, those databases work differently. We'll talk about the relational model in a few seconds, but basically this point is about the relational model. That in the modern incarnation, what we call relational database management systems, I would call them the third wave, because to me, so hierarchical database is the first wave. Then there was this attempt, which was almost coincided in time with the hierarchical databases. There was something called network databases. So when I was a student in the late 1970s, early 1980s, some of my professors who worked with databases, there were adherents of the new relational model. And there were other ones who said, well, you know, network databases are faster, which was true at the time. But network databases never became really popular. So it was like this stepping stone. But in relational databases, as you will see, there is this very interesting thing. So the different data sets in the database can be in relations which are established by common attributes. So if a database is designed properly, if we eliminate data redundancy, then we eliminate the problem of coordinating data updates. because any data update in the numbers of the data group. Okay, so this is the ambition. And we don't have to worry about defining the data structures, creating, updating management data. It is all taken care of by the database management system. So this is a very quick summary of the advantages of this relational database approach. And they are generic in the sense that they apply to pretty much any properly designed database management system. So the primary thing is we go after data redundancy. If we manage to eliminate data redundancy, then it actually solves the whole set of other issues. Okay? So if there is no data redundancy, then there is no way for data inconsistency. Because data become inconsistent only if you store the same data element more than once. Then you update it in one place, you don't update it in another place, and you get into an inconsistent state, right? If every data element is stored only once, there is still a likelihood that it is incorrect. By the way, that's another thing. So people often confuse consistency with correctness, okay? So eliminating data redundancy eliminates the possibility for inconsistency. But the data may still be incorrect, which should be very easy to understand. For example, you have a record of your customers. Your customer moves and changes the phone number, and they don't let you know. So you have that record of a customer in a single place. There is no other copies. So there is no inconsistency in your system, right? But that record is still incorrect because it has not been updated with the right information. So consistency and correctness are two different issues. Eliminating data redundancy eliminates the possibility for inconsistencies. Correctness is a separate issue. Okay? So data independence. Databases have to store the descriptions of the data, so it's all in the databases. When you develop applications, you can make an application to ask the database for the description of the data elements and then parse it. So this, of course, accelerates the development of applications, which is very important. And the databases provide you the centralized control, backup, and security features. So this is the reason why there is a special job description called Database Administrator. DBA. Have you heard this? No. So it's a job description. It's a very important job because that's the person responsible for live data. So fairly well compensated. Probably not the highest paid, but fairly well paid. Huh? It is not an easy job at all. I can tell you that if anything, so those guys there, yeah, they're pretty decently paid, but this is nerve-wracking. I can tell you that I have friends who have been doing this. So in the old days, those guys were carrying their beepers with them everywhere, literally. And when they were going on vacation, even if they had somebody who was covering for them, they would still go with their laptop and make sure that they have a connection, because God forbid anything happens, they have to get into the system and figure it out. I can tell you that if I had to work in that industry, I'd rather work as a developer rather than a database administrator. I would rather write new code and try to develop stuff and solve new puzzles rather than have the headache of knowing that, God forbid, something breaks in the database and your processing cycles cannot go through, or if you're a trading corporation, that the trading day is starting and the system is not there. It's a catastrophe. So you are always living in this state of fear, permanent, that something can break. It's like, no, it is definitely not an easy job. Also, the reason why it may be a good job in the sense of job security, because you know, you can get a lot of very smart guys out of school who are star developers. You know that writing code fast, I mean, it's the domain of very young people. So would be difficult for me to compete with the youngsters on speed. They would definitely write it faster than I do. Okay? But in database administration, experience is an absolutely critical thing, because there are a lot of things that you don't learn in school when you work with those databases. And you really have to accumulate. You can accumulate, if you have a couple of decades of database experience behind your belt, you become a very, very valuable person. So, no, it's definitely not an easy job. It has its benefits, but not an easy job. Well, if you're a cool character, I mean, it depends on the personality. There are people who handle stress better than others. So you definitely have to be in a position to handle stress well, because it's going to be very stressful. Okay, other questions? Okay, drawbacks.
Yeah.
Well, I kind of alluded. You see, it was an unexpected discussion, but the reason for all those DBAs. So it's not simple. So database management systems are not simple. I mean, not at our level, you know, but when you really have to get to the technicality. So yeah, I mean, it requires experience. So certain features are complex. We will talk about very simple things, but you will see that you will have to actually to make an effort to understand this. So it requires certain level of rigor. Now, the third point is interesting. Now, when you work with a database and it works properly, so it exposes you the interface so you can get to the data, you get the data elements. What happens if your database breaks down? Well, the data is still stored somewhere, right? So I told you that it still works with some files. So what imagine that you cannot start a database. It's a program. You start a program, it crashes. So you cannot start a database. And you cannot migrate your data into another system to see maybe a different instance of the same database will be able to read the data. So you still have the data on the hard drive of your computer. So can you get to that data? Well, I mean, you can look at those zeros and ones. You remember we talked about this. So there are ways you can examine those zeros and ones. But those zeros and ones will be in a very, very complicated format. Okay? So it is every database uses its very particular transformations when it stores the data, because they have to packet title, they have to make sure that they get to it easily. So there are a lot of things. So the end result for us users is that, you know, if the database is gone, even though the data is there, it can be a major problem how to get it. So you cannot easily start another program and examine the data. So the data is available through the database, that's it. So you'd better make sure that it runs. Now, another thing is, you know, in the previous slide we said that the centralized backup control and security is an advantage here, so that it's a disadvantage. Why? Well, because again, this also eliminates redundancy. If you had a file-based application, and that application trashes that file. If there is another application which uses a different version of this file, that may not be trashed, right? So you may be able to recover. Or if, say, an application has a flaw in it, and the data can be exposed to the outside. In the case of file-based systems, only the files used by a particular application are exposed. Now, in the case of such an integrated database, this is, as computer scientists call, single point of failure. So if there is a problem there, that's it. Everything is exposed. So everything crashes. So you crash a backup, all the backup is gone, not just the one. So there is a hole in it, somebody can break in, they get access to absolutely everything in the database. And I assume that you have heard about all these horror stories about the break-ins, the latest fiasco with Equifax, right? You know about it. By the way, you all should know and you all should care. This is as serious as it gets. I think it's probably the worst that I've seen. It's, we I'm not even sure what all the consequences will be. I cannot recommend it, but you may want to think about freezing access to markets. So again, so this is our hierarchy that we talked about. So let's talk about the databases and let's talk about their features. Okay. We already talked about primary keys. And this is gonna be a very important thing in the relational databases. In every relational table, there will be one unique identifier, which is gonna be designated as the primary key, and this is how you identify different variants. Okay. Again, composite or concatenated means that it consists of more than one attribute. And if the field is not in the key, then it's a non-key. Now, the first three are familiar. The fourth one is not. So, and this is the new thing which is introduced in the relational database world. When you have the different data sets, for example, you have a record of customers, you have records of your customers, and you have records of your credit sales, right? So those are two different data sets. There is no doubt that they must be related, right? Why? Because the data set describing your customers actually describes those entities that you made sales to. So how do we establish a relationship between these two data sets? We establish it by means of common attributes, which will be called foreign keys. So this is what a foreign key means. Okay. So at the more technical level, so one of the data sets will have an attribute, which should be the same attribute as the primary key in another data set. In my example, in the data set describing customers, the primary key most likely will be something called the customer ID. Right? So you will introduce the identifiers of your customers. So in the data set describing your customers, there will be this customer ID, which is the primary key. Every customer will have a different customer ID. Then, when you create a record of a sale, in that record of a sale, you will also have the customer ID attribute because it will specify who actually got the thing. So it specifies the identity of the customer. So in the sales table, the customer ID attribute will be specified as a foreign key because the value in that key must match an existing customer ID in the customer's table. Where this is going to be the primary. So we'll talk more about this. Now, these common attributes will be used to model different types of relationships. And again, this is just a very brief introduction. We are going to talk about this in more details later. So when we discuss different business entities, we will realize that depending on their nature, their relationships may be the so-called one-to-one, one-to-many, and many-to-many. So it's the easiest to give you an example using what we discussed in the previous chapter, say a student information system. So let's talk about students. So in the case of students, let's say you, well, what is, what would be an example of one-to-one? Say a student ID and a social security number, right? So for every student ID, there is only one social security number. And for every social security number, there is only one student ID. If we pretend for a second that you can have only a single major, that you are not allowed to double major. Okay, let's, and there are schools where this is the rule. Pretend for a second that the school has the rule that you can have only one major. Then the relationship between students and majors will be one to many. Because every student can have only one major, but for a particular major, there will be many students who have that major. So if you look at the relationship between students and classes, then this will be an example of a many-to-many relationship. Why? Because a student can take several different classes, not a single class. But in the same class, you can have several students, not just one student. Okay, so again, we are going to get back to these examples. But you will see that they are modeled differently in the relationship. So we will still use common attributes. We will always use common attributes for inputs. But the way we do it will be different depending on which type of the relationship we are modeling. Questions? Okay. This is about terminology. And it's a little bit confusing because there are two different, very similar terms, but they mean different things. I just talked about the relationships. Now there is something called relation. A relation, think about it as a synonym for a table. Okay? For a table or a file. Okay? So a relation is not the same as a relationship. So we discussed relationships on the previous slide. And a relation, think of it as just a synonym, a fancy word for a table. Okay? And I'll try not to use it. I will use a lot the word relationships. I will avoid using the word relation. The reason why you see it is because it isn't the name of the, we talk about relational systems. And because the original description of the relational database management systems was done in purely mathematical terms. So this is a mathematical term, mathematicians. So in information systems, we are trying to use some different terms. So, but relation, our modern database systems were invented basically by a mathematician. Well, they call him computer scientist, his name was Kahn. And he was a PhD. And they believe that probably at that time there was no PhD yet in computer science. So he probably got into some technology. He worked for IBM. So he was a computer scientist or a doctor in computer science working for IBM. And he wrote a paper describing this relational database model in purely mathematical terms. And it was published a long time ago. It was published 47 years in the fall of 1970. In a professional journal called Communications of the Association for and that was the beginning of relational databases. And it took a while, it took probably around 15 years for this theoretical model to become an important commercial product. Actually, people started doing it pretty fast. IBM initiated research prototypes. Relational databases. So they started developing relational databases, but that computing technology didn't allow them to be very productive. So they were very slow databases. But they kept persisting and eventually, you know, after a while, IBM invested a lot of money into this, and they now have one of the best relational database products on the market is an IBM DB2 database, which is a successor of those early research prototypes. So the IBM has been doing this for close to 50 years, just in the relational database management systems space. You see here the name Oracle. You probably have heard about the company called Oracle. Have you heard about this company? It's one of the largest computer companies. Oracle is interesting because, you know, they founded the company to develop relational database management systems. If my memory doesn't betray me, I think Oracle was founded in something like 1976. So just think about this. So in 1974, published basically a mathematical article, and then there was some research developments. And IBM was playing with this research prototype, and it didn't look like there was any hope that it would be commercially viable, because you know it was not even in the ballpark of the performance of IMS that was a commercial database at that time. And they started a new company with the idea to develop this into a commercial product. So it's not surprising that Oracle is one of the leading relational database vendors in the market, because they were very good at this game. And by the way, keep in mind that this is very risky. Those people really, they put their skin in the game. It's not like, yeah, now looking back, you know, as they say, Monday morning quarterback. Yeah, you know. But there was no way to know at that time whether it would work out or not. So it was a tremendous risk, a lot of effort. And then there were other databases and startups. There was a very interesting database called Informix. For historians, it's a very interesting lesson, because it had some very interesting and unique features, was very aggressively developed, got into financial troubles. What is interesting for accountants, they had to restate their financial statements. So they got into some serious financial troubles, were acquired by IBM. IBM bought Informix. Microsoft SQL Server, I mentioned, this is an enterprise strength database by Microsoft. Very interesting history. Microsoft was not in the business of developing relational databases originally. And they realized that it was becoming important. So they wanted to have their own product, but they didn't really have the development team yet. So they made a deal with another kind of like a startup, but at that time again it was a very established company called Sybase, which was very, very popular. By the way, if 25 years ago you wanted to work with data on Wall Street, in the majority of firms, I would think, they would use Sybase. They were interesting business, so Wall Street was very, very hard on Sybase. So Microsoft sold rebranded versions of Sybase as the early versions of Microsoft SQL Server. So if you look at the very earliest in history, very earliest versions of Microsoft SQL Server, it was basically Sybase under another name. I believe that started with version 6, if I'm not mistaken. That was already a Microsoft product. So that's also very interesting. So Microsoft has been known that, you know, that they may not get certain things right from the beginning, but they were very persistent. They would keep pushing and pushing and pushing and improving until they get it right. So they didn't have this enterprise strength database. So they started getting into that. They started putting resources. Then they got their own product. Then they improved it so much that these days it is a very highly reputable database. Microsoft SQL Server is a very good relational database, excellent, particularly for medium-sized enterprises. Probably unhidden. Well, I'm sorry, we'll talk about it. It's in this chapter. SQL, SQL stands for the structured query language. And in this area, SQL is pronounced as SQL. So I apologize, I should have talked. Yes, it's just rolls off the end of the mouth. SQL, we'll talk more about SQL. So SQL is often pronounced as SQL. Okay? Yeah, you can say Microsoft SQL Server, but don't be surprised if you hear Microsoft SQL Server. It's the same thing. Just the way to pronounce it. You know, those computer acronyms are not always pronounced the way they're written. So, okay, so you'll see that relational databases basically deal with tables, which consist of records, and every record is a set of attributes or fields. So what is a relational database? A relational database is a collection of related tables. So every table consists of a set of records. And every record consists of a set of attribute values. How do we define a structure of a relational database? We define it by describing the tables and their relationships. And you see here on this slide an example of a structure of a relational database. So this is how we define a structure of a relational database. This is, of course, a fragment which represents the main data sets that we need in this order to cache cycle that I talked about. So if you think about what kind of data you need in your company to run this order to cache cycle, then these would be the data sets. So this slide may look a little bit mysterious to you. So let's talk about what is presented here. So every line on the slide represents a table. Those tables are identified by their names. So tables in a relational database are identified by their names. So in this case, you see seven tables. And those tables are called sales regions, customers, sales orders, items ordered, collections, order collections, and items. So each line represents an individual table. And again, the identifier of a table is the name. So no two tables can have the same name, because otherwise we would not be able to identify. So for every table, we describe its structure by listing the attributes in the table. What do I mean by saying that I list the attributes? Well, I have to use the attribute identifiers. The attribute or field identifiers are their names. So in the same way as tables are identified by their names, attributes within tables are also identified by their names. For example, sales region table consists of three attributes. Okay, one attribute is region number, another one is description, and one more is manager. So those are attributes, okay? So table customers has attributes customer number, name, address, balance, and credit limit, and so forth. Any questions about this? Yes. No, it's a table. This is where I store my data. I didn't say a word about application problems. There is nothing about processing here. This is only the description of the data. You will have to process that data. That's a separate matter. But at this stage, remember, we talk about databases are to separate data from processing. So we are describing what our data is. Okay? So identify tables by their names, list attributes by their names for each of the tables. So what is the significance of underlying attributes? Those are the primary keys. So when you see underlined attributes in any of the tables, they identify the primary key in that table. So in table sales regions, the primary key is region number. In table items ordered, the primary key is actually a composite key, which consists of two attributes, order number and item number. So you remember we talked about that you may have the primary key consisting of more than one attribute. So an example of this is in the table items order. So the primary key consists of two attributes, order number and item number. Any questions about this? So what is the significance of the postfixes? You see that next to some of the attributes, you see asterisks. Asterisks in this notation identify foreign keys. So when you see an asterisk next to an attribute, it identifies a foreign key. So in the sales orders table, the attribute customer number is actually a foreign key, meaning that it establishes a relationship between sales orders and customers. So customer number is the common attribute with the customer's table, and therefore in the sales orders table, it is a foreign key. So we'll talk about referential integrity a few slides later, and you will see that basically it means that the values here must come from this table. So only customer numbers which are listed in the customer's table can appear in the sales orders, which makes perfect sense, right? Any questions? Okay, then let me draw your attention to another interesting thing. So as I said, order number and item number pair are the composite primary key in the items order table. But now you also see the asterisks next to the order number and next to the item number. Okay, so focus on this. So on the one hand, they're underlined, right? So they're underlined, meaning that they're the primary key. On the other hand, you see those asterisks. And I just told you that asterisks identify foreign keys. So what is it? Are they the primary keys or are they foreign keys? They are both, which is perfectly fine. As a matter of fact, it's very important, you'll see later on, that, again, I'm jumping a little bit ahead, but whenever we will implement many-to-many relationships in the relational database, you will necessarily see this, okay? So when you see this kind of structure, that you see a composite primary key, and every attribute in that composite primary key is also a foreign key at the same time, so it should ring the bell that most likely this is a so-called relationship or bridge table for the many-to-many relationship. But we'll talk about that later. Okay, so basically this order number is a common attribute for the sales orders table, right? And the item number is the common attribute for the items table, which is basically, by the way, it's called items here. But this is basically your inventory table, right? So the last line of this slide is basically your inventory. I mean, in a simplified form. Okay? Questions about this? No. No. So, again, it's an excellent leading question because the next slide contains the so-called rules for tables. Okay? And so, what are the rules? Well, let's see if I manage to put this slide. I have just a few minutes left. So I already mentioned some of them. So first of all, we have to be able to identify the table, so they must have unique names. Very simple. duplicate columns and rows are not permitted within a table. Okay, there are two parts here. There is a part about duplicate rows, and there is a part about duplicate columns. And they are essentially different. I have to take them one by one. The part about duplicate rows is actually fairly simple and should be obvious to you. Since every table must have a primary key, we'll talk about that, this is one of the points of the slide. It is impossible to have duplicate rows. Why? Because if you had two identical rows in the table, then what would happen? There would not be the unique primary key. Because if they are completely identical, then their values in the primary key must be the same. But the primary key is a unique identifier, meaning that different rows must have different values, right? So this part is simple. So what about duplicate columns? Now, duplicate columns actually means something else. Duplicate column means the prohibition of duplicate columns means that within a table, no two attributes can have the same name. So when we list attributes, I cannot have two attributes called description in the sales regions table. Okay? Can I? So this is exactly what it means. It's different because, you know, in the case of rows, we talked about the values of the attributes in the when we talked about the prohibition of duplication. In the case of columns, we actually talk about the names of the columns, not about the values of the attributes. As a matter of fact, if it is perfectly okay if you have two columns with different names, but in every record in the table, both of those attributes have exactly the same value. I can even show you on this example how this can happen. So for example, imagine that it so happens that in the case of your customers, every customer maxed out the credit limit. And again, I'm exaggerating, right? It's not likely to happen in real life, but it's possible, right? It's not absurd to think about. So imagine a situation where every one of your customers maxed out the credit limit. So what does it mean? It means that exactly the balance on every customer's account is exactly the credit limit, which is okay, right? We allow the credit limit. But then think about these two columns in the customer's table, the credit limit column and the balance column. In this case, every record will have exactly the same values in both columns, which is okay. This is not prohibited. This is not called duplication of columns because the names of the columns differ. One is called balance and the other one is called credit limit. Is that clear? So this is my point. So the prohibition of the duplication of columns means that within a table, no two columns can have exactly the same name.